Our Heavenly Father, as I bow my head and heart before God and shut my eyes in Thy presence, I beg and beseech in the name of Jesus, who came into this world to lay His life down that we might have life, He came to seek and to save that which was lost. It's in His name, and through the shed blood of His cross, I beg for the leadership of the Spirit of God. Dear Lord God, not only on this end of the line, but in the homes and in the hearts that are listening to my voice right now. Father, I plead the blood against the devil, and I claim souls as we discuss the Bible subject of hell day by day. Now give me wisdom, Father, and I'll give God the praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, I want to talk to you just a moment right out of my heart, and I want to give you some of the ideas about hell today. Now, this man that wrote the article in the magazine that I have here on my desk, and I have it in black and white, and it's a fact, and it's been circulated to the tune of thousands of copies. Now, he says that hell is a place of purification. In other words, he says that fire purifies. Well, that's true. That's true. Fire sterilizes. You can burn a needle, and it's sterile, it's clean, it kills all the germs. That's true. But now, this man says that hell is a place where people are purified and made ready for the world to come. And he says, of course, that the very nature of God would not permit a soul to be tormented forever. Now then, in this land of ours today, hell is being denied as it is taught in the Word of God. Now, beloved, I believe this. I believe the Bible says what it means, and I believe the Bible means what it says. Now, that's what I believe. I believe that with all of my heart. All right. Now, today, we are being taught that hell is not a place where fires burn and where souls beg for water to cool their parching tongues. We're told today that when the wicked die, they are unconscious. They're just like a dog or a cat or a chicken or a cow or a hog. They die. Their body goes back to the dust, and that's it. Then, of course, sometime later, they'll be raised and they'll be judged, and then they'll be burned up. And that'll be the end of them. I heard with my own ears an outstanding religionist make this statement. He read a letter, and the letter said, "Someone told me that you do not believe in hell. Do you believe in hell? Please answer this on the radio." And this man read that letter. "Please tell me if you believe in hell." And the man said, "Why, certainly I believe in hell. Certainly I believe in hell." So does the man that wrote the article here. What happened to hell? He believes in hell. He believes in his version of hell. Now, this man, I heard this with my own ears. My wife and I were riding in my automobile on Sunday morning, going to a service, to one of our services, and I heard this man make statement. He said, "Certainly I believe in hell." And he said, "If you don't repent and come to Jesus, hell will be the end of you. Hell will be the end of you." Well, now, some people said, "Why, somebody said that fellow doesn't believe in hell." Why, sure he believes now. Listen, there are a lot of people today who believe in hell, but they have fashioned their own hell. They have taken the hell in the Bible, and they've trimmed it down, and they've cut corners, and they have made the Bible teach what they wanted to teach. Now, we're not going to do that. As I sit here at my desk today, I have before me an open Bible, a King James, an authorized King James version of the Word of God. And we're going to use this Bible as a textbook, and we're going to use it and it alone to see what God would have us to know about this business of hell. Now, let me go on just a moment further, and then we're going to read some Scripture. Now, men have fashioned their own hell. They say the grave is hell. Now that's being taught, and there are hundreds of thousands of people in America that believe that hell is the grave, and the grave is hell. Now they believe that. They believe the wicked dead are unconscious, and their bodies and their souls and their spirits and all there is to them is in the grave, unconscious, awaiting the resurrection morning and the judgment morning. Now, there are tens and hundreds of thousands in America that believe that. All right. The grave is hell. The wicked are unconscious. The soul, the spirit, and the body are dead and unconscious in the grave. And they'll be raised and judged and burned up. Now, there are tens and hundreds of thousands who believe that. Then there are others who believe that hell is a house of correction, just like this man. where souls go and they are corrected. In other words, it's a place of purifying. And they're purified, and then they're made ready for heaven, and in the end, all of God's creatures will be like Jesus, and they're all of God's creatures, all men, all women. It makes no difference how wicked they've been or what they've done or what they haven't done. They'll all go to heaven, they'll all be corrected, and they'll all step inside the pearly gates. Now, that is the teaching. And then, of course, the accounts in the New Testament concerning hellfire is symbolized and warped and twisted to fit men's ideas. Then they come back with that old argument that a God of love wouldn't send his children to hell. All right. Now, what we're going to do, we're going to take this Bible, we're going to read it, we're going to see what this book teaches about hell, and we're going to accept it as God has laid it down. Now, I challenge you, I give you a challenge. Junk your religious books and get your Bible and let us study what this book has to say about hell. Now, the first time you'll find the word hell in the New Testament is in Matthew chapter 5. Matthew chapter 5, and I'll begin reading with verse 22. But I say unto you that whosoever is angry with his brother without a cause shall be in danger of the judgment. All right. And whosoever shall say to his brother, Raca, shall be in danger of the council. I know. But whosoever shall say, thou fool, shall be in danger of hell fire. Now, these words were spoken by the tender, loving, compassionate Lamb of God that the modernist and the liberal and the no-hellite likes to talk about as the tender Jesus that wouldn't judge a man and wouldn't permit a soul to burn in hell. Now, listen, beloved, I want to show you a few little things about this statement, and then we'll move on to some other scripture. Now, the first time the word hell is used in the New Testament, it is spoken from the lips of the lovely Son of God. And when I say lovely, I say it with all tenderness. He was lovely. He certainly was. He was tender. He certainly was. He was compassionate. He certainly was. Yes, Jesus was the tender, loving, compassionate, gentle Lamb of God. And according to Hebrews 12:29, He's a consuming fire. Let's not preach a one-sided gospel. Listen, beloved. I don't have any axes to grind. I don't have any denominations to please. I don't have any traditions to defend, God bless you. I don't have anybody telling me what to preach, when to preach, where to preach, how to preach. I just preach. That's all. Been doing it for almost a quarter of a century. God has fed me and kept clothes on my back. God has always given me a place to preach. And I tell you, I'm too old, and I've gone too far down this road, God bless you, to start scratching backs and compromising and soaping now. Let's read the book, let's see what it says, believe what it says, preach what it says, and live by what the Bible says. All right. Hell, fire. Now, hell and fire is connected right there. Now, listen, beloved. Listen, I want to ask you a question. If Jesus did not mean a place burning with fire, why did Jesus say, whosoever shall say, thou fool, shall be in danger of going to a place that is in a measure and to a degree and by chance like a place that would have something like fire in it? Now let me tell you something. The Son of God didn't beat around the bush. And the Son of God pulled no punches. And the Son of God did not soft pedal what he said. Jesus said, if you call your brother a fool, you're in danger of hell fire. Now, that's settled. It doesn't make any difference what doctor sounding brass, nor professor tinkling cymbal, nor this would-be theologian or that would-be. Listen, brother, listen. You can take this Bible and take a little bit here and a little bit there and a little portion here and a little portion there and add a little and take away a little and warp a little and twist a little, and bless your heart, you can prove anything under the sun that you want to prove. But you are to study and you are to rightly divide the word of truth. Now, Jesus said that hell is a place where there's fire. Now, it doesn't matter what anybody says about it. You can't change it. Those words fell from the lips of Jesus. It's a funny thing to me that the liberals want to talk about and the modernists, and those who deny hell, they want to talk about the marvelous Sermon on the Mount. Yes, the marvelous. Blessed is the peacemaker, and blessed is this, and blessed is that. Yes, blessed, yes. Jesus said, blessed is the peacemaker, and blessed is this, and blessed is that. But he also said, if you call your brother a fool, you're in danger of hell fire. Now, let's face the thing. Let's face it. Let's be honest and fair and square with the Word of God. And let's stop taking a little part that we lack and proving our little religious points. I've tried, as I have thought for one solid month, and I've been planning and praying and working and studying and digging for a solid month on this series of sermons. And I've tried my best down through the days of the month to figure out why in the name of common sense a preacher would go to the pulpit or go on the radio or write a sermon and tear down a Bible hell. Listen, suppose, now I won't talk to you, now just let's use a little sensible, down-to-earth, common sense illustration. Suppose that I was the governor of some state, just any state. We won't name any state. Suppose I was the governor of your state. And suppose you use the electric chair. That's what we use in the state of South Carolina still, the electric chair. And if a man is guilty and is proven guilty of a crime that calls for capital punishment, that man is sentenced, or woman, is sentenced to die in the electric chair. All right, I'm the governor. Suppose I write an article in every newspaper in the state, in every magazine that comes in the state, and suppose I make a statewide broadcast and I say, now listen, you folks who murder and you folks who are guilty of assault and rape and kidnapping, now according to the laws of the state, that is a capital crime, and the law says if you murder or kidnap or if you're guilty of these things, you'll die in the electric chair. Now that's what the law says, but now listen, it's not really an electric chair. Don't let anybody fool you, see. It's just a chair down there, but there's no electricity in it. And you're not going to die. You might get a little shock, but you won't die. Now listen to that. You say, preacher, that's silly. No, that's not silly. No. Listen, the law of the land says if a man is guilty of first-degree murder, he'll pay with his own life. And if I go and I say to the people, it doesn't mean that. It doesn't mean that you'll die in the electric chair. It doesn't mean that you'll die in the gas chamber. It's symbolic. You won't die. You may get frightened a little bit, and you may be shocked a little bit, and you might get a little bit sick, but you're not going to die. Listen, brother. Listen, friend. Listen. God bless you. If I was the governor of some state and I did that, I'd be impeached, and I should. I'd be put in jail. Now, let me tell you something. I say this from a heart of love. I say it from a heart of love. How in the name of common sense can a preacher go to the pulpit, come to the radio, and sit down at a typewriter and destroy hell fire and take the fire out of hell and render hell the grave and do away with the teaching of everlasting judgment and condemnation upon the wicked? How can he do it? I tell you, brother, God bless your heart, I'd hate to be in his boots when he stands before God. Hell is a place where there is fire. This is not symbolic. It doesn't say as it were. It doesn't say in a measure. It doesn't say symbolic. It's not a parable. Jesus said, if you say to your brother, you're a fool, then you are in danger of hell fire. Now, one other thing that I want to say today. When God created this earth, there was no hell. God didn't need a hell. No, God didn't need a hell, and there was no hell. In the beginning, Genesis 1:1, in the beginning, God created the heavens, or the heaven singular, and the earth. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. Now, it doesn't say one thing about God creating hell. God didn't need a hell. There was no sin. Now, when sin started, I don't know. There's no man can answer. The Bible doesn't give us a date. I know where it started and I know how it started, but I can't tell you when it started. But I can say this, in the beginning there was no sin. In the beginning God created the heaven and God created the earth. There was no hell. Now the reason God created hell and God prepared hell, God made hell, God brought into existence hell, the reason God needed a prison. God needed a penitentiary because sin had come into the world and come into the universe and sin had been committed and there were sinners that had to be put in chains and God had to make or God had to prepare or create a hell. Now in Matthew 25:41, then shall he say also unto them on the left hand, depart from me, ye cursed, into everlasting fire, prepared for the devil and his angels. Now, when God created hell, I have no date to give you. But God did not create hell in the beginning. I can tell you that. God created hell when the devil became a devil and when the angels sinned. God made a place to reserve those angels in chains, in darkness, until the judgment day, and God created hell, and God prepared hell for the devil and the devil's angels. Now let me say this, and I must close, my time is gone. Hell was not prepared for you. Hell was not prepared for me. You're not one of the devil's angels, and you're not a devil. You're not a devil, and you're not one of the devil's angels. You're God's creation. God created you in the image of God, and God wanted you to serve Jesus. And if you'll serve Jesus, you can spend eternity with Jesus. But if you refuse to serve Jesus and choose to serve the devil, then you'll have to spend eternity in hell. Now, we'll talk more about it. But remember, there is a hell. You may never believe it this side the grave, but 5 seconds after you're dead, you'll believe it. Father, in the name of Jesus, save every sinner that's listening to my voice. Save those who are under conviction. I plead the blood, and I claim them for Jesus because he died for them. In his saving name, amen. Our Heavenly Father, as we continue our study today of the Word of God, I pray that you'll lead us and guide us and direct us by the Spirit. And Father, save souls today as they listen in the great unseen radio audience. For Jesus' sake, amen. I'm delivering a series of sermons on the subject hell. What is hell? Where is hell? Who's there? What are they doing? Who's going? What will they do? And so on. Now, I mentioned yesterday a magazine article, and I have it in my hand. And the title of the article is, What Has Happened to Hell? The first paragraph reads as follows. A thoughtful man recently remarked to me, now the man that wrote the article made that statement, here's what the man said. Years ago, the pulpits of our country had a great deal to say about the fires of hell. Now you rarely even hear about the place. What I want to know is, what has happened to hell? Now let me say this. Not anything has happened to hell. What I want to know is, what I want to know, what Oliver Green wants to know, is this, what has happened to some dear preachers? That's what I want to know. Now, I'm not criticizing preachers. God said, touch not mine anointed. And I've got better sense than to put my hands on God's preachers. But I'm saying this, I'm asking a question. Can a man be God's preacher and leave hell out of his ministry? Now, I want you to make up your mind as we study day by day. Now, yesterday, I read to you in Matthew chapter 5, the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus said, if we call, or if a man call his brother a fool, that man is in danger of hell fire. Now, I said that Jesus was the first person in the New Testament to use the word hell and to connect fire with the word hell. Then I said on yesterday that in the beginning there was no hell, and there was not. In the beginning God created the heaven and the earth. That's Genesis 1:1. In the beginning God created the heaven and the earth. There was no hell in the beginning. The reason? God didn't need one. There was no devil. There was no sin. Now, I had a letter in today's mail that dumbfounded me. I mean by that, I can't understand how any man could make such a statement. This minister, according to the lady who wrote in and asked a question and wanted to know the truth, she wasn't criticizing. She wanted to know the truth. She wanted to know where she could find some Bible to help her. And she said that her preacher said that God created sin. And if God had not created sin, there wouldn't be any sin. Well, now, that's not true, beloved. That is absolutely untrue. Now, there was no hell in the beginning. But when the devil came into existence and when sin came into existence, then God was forced to prepare a hell. Now, let's see what we can find out about this business of where sin originated and where the devil came from and who made the devil and how come we have a devil and why doesn't God kill the devil and all that. All right, in Ezekiel chapter 28, we find a very interesting account in the Word of God. Now, you say, Brother Green, you're going to read that account about the king of Tyre. Listen, beloved. Listen. The Bible is a book that is written so that those who are willing to let the Spirit teach them can understand it. God has hidden these things from the wise and prudent and revealed them unto babes. But if you're not willing to let the Spirit of God teach you and guide you, you'll never understand the Word of God. You can't understand. It's impossible. Now then, in reading Ezekiel 28, we find the story of two personalities. One is a literal king, and the other is a created being. Now, the Bible is not an ordinary book. It's not a book of fiction. You can't pick it up and read it, and read it like you do a newspaper or a book of fiction, and hope to understand what the Word of God is saying, what the Word of God teaches, and what God is saying to you and to me. But if you let the Spirit teach you, and compare Scripture with Scripture, and spiritual things with spiritual things, then you can understand the Word of God. All right. Now then, in Ezekiel chapter 28 and verse 11, moreover, the Word of the Lord came to me, saying, verse 12 now, Son of man, take up a lamentation upon the king of Tyrus, and say unto him, Thus saith the Lord God, Thou sealest up the sum, full of wisdom, and perfect in duty. Now, I want you to follow me, and notice this man, or this personality, I should say, and notice the things the Word of God says about him. So, verse 13, Thou hast been in Eden, the garden of God. Every precious stone was thy covering. Then he names all the stones, and then in the last part of the verse, and it says, Prepared in thee in the day that thou wast created. Now, this person that I'm reading about was not born like I was born, not even like Jesus was born. Jesus was born of a virgin. Now, I was born of my parents. My mother gave me life. But this man was created. This personality was created. The Bible says so. Now, God only created one man. That was Adam. And God removed a rib from Adam's side and made Eve out of a rib that he removed from Adam's side. So, in the true sense of the word, God created only one being. And that being that God created was Adam. That is, from the standpoint of man. Now, this person was created. All right, verse 14. Thou art the anointed cherub that covereth. Thou art the anointed cherub that covereth. Notice that. And I have set thee so. Thou wast upon the holy mountain of God. Now, where is that? Where is the holy mountain of God? Now, I believe with all of my heart that I do no injustice to Scripture when I say that it's God's home, it's God's throne. It's over yonder, beloved friends, in the third heaven where God lives. That's the holy mountain of God. Now then, thou hast walked up and down in the midst of the stones of fire. That's in God's house. Now, thou wast perfect. P-E-R-F-E-C-T. Thou wast perfect in thy ways from the day that thou wast created till iniquity was found in thee. Now, this person that Ezekiel is telling us about was perfect in wisdom, perfect in duty, perfect in all of his ways from the day that God created him. Now, beloved, there's only been one perfect man apart from Adam. Adam was perfect up to the time he sinned. And Jesus came into the world and He lived perfection. He never sinned. This created being was a perfect being until iniquity was found in Him. Now then, notice please, now get this. This personality had been in the garden of God and He had walked upon the mountain of God and He had walked in and out among the stones of fire. Now keep that in mind and turn to Isaiah chapter 14 and we find these words. Isaiah 14 and verse 9. Hail from beneath is moved for thee to meet thee at thy coming. It stirreth up the dead for thee. Even all the chief ones of the earth it hath raised up from their thrones, all the kings of the nations. All they shall speak and say unto thee, art thou also become weak as we? Art thou become like unto us? Now this is a prophecy referring to the time when the devil, and he is a mighty being. He's a mighty being. And beloved, so far as power is concerned, He's mighty, and there's only one that is mightier, and that's God Almighty and the Godhead. Now, Michael did not rebuke the devil in Jude. Michael didn't rebuke him, but he said, the Lord rebuke you. Michael knew too much about the devil to argue with him, and Michael refused to argue with him. Now then, so let's read verse 11. Thy pomp is brought down to the grave, and the noise of thy vows, the worm is spread unto thee, and the worms cover thee. Now then, verse 12. How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? How art thou cut down to the ground which did weaken the nations? For thou hast said in thine heart, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will sit upon the mount. Now remember, in Ezekiel 28, this person had walked on the mountain of God in the stones of fire. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High. Now he said, I will sit upon the mount of the congregation in the sides of the north. I will ascend out of the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High, yet thou shalt be brought down to hell to the sides of the pit. Now I believe, and most outstanding Bible scholars, and I'm certainly not an outstanding Bible scholar, I'm just a poor country preacher, but most outstanding Bible scholars agree that these two personalities, Lucifer and this one in Ezekiel 28, are one and the same person. Now, this person, before he became the devil, the deceiver, was the anointed cherub that covereth, the shining one, Lucifer, son of the morning. In other words, I frankly believe with all of my heart that this created being was next to the Godhead. Now, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit make up the Godhead. They have been almighty from everlasting and will be to everlasting. But I personally believe that Lucifer, the anointed cherub that covereth, perfect in beauty, perfect in wisdom, perfect in all of his ways, he walked in the mountain of God among the stones of fire, and every precious stone was his covering. I believe he was next to God. I believe he was the chief archangel. I believe he was the high sheriff of heaven. But iniquity was born in his heart. Iniquity manufactured itself inside of him. Iniquity was found in him. And when God found iniquity in him, God cast him out, and God had to create a prison, a penitentiary, a hell, to put the angels in that this personality led astray when he attempted to overthrow God. Now, Jude tells us very plainly that the angels which left their first estate, angels are special creations of God. They are ministering spirits to the heirs of salvation. We're not going to be angels when we get to heaven. No, no. No, we're going to be sons of God. Angels are special creations of God. They are created beings. We are born, that is, physically, and we're born again spiritually. We're God's sons by birth. We are the sons of men by physical birth. We're the sons of God by spiritual birth. Now then, Lucifer led astray some of the angels, and Lucifer plus these angels decided to push God off the throne, take God's throne. He said, I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I'll sit in the mountain of the congregation of the righteous in the sides of the north. I'll ascend my throne above the stars of heaven. And when Lucifer, the shining one, the anointed cherub that covereth, the high sheriff of heaven, when he decided, along with some of the angels, to overthrow God and take God's throne, then God threw him out. Jesus said, I saw Satan as lightning fall from heaven. Now, I believe that has been fulfilled, and I believe it will be fulfilled again. That is, I believe that it'll actually happen again. But I believe that when God threw the shining one out of heaven, now remember, he was the shining one, and Jesus said in Matthew, I saw Satan as lightning fall from heaven. Now, Satan was such a bright, beautiful, shining creature that when God threw him out, it looked like a streak of lightning across the sky when he fell from the mountain of God down to the earth. Now, before this series is over, I will prove to you, if you'll accept Scripture, I'll prove to you that hell is in the center of this earth. Now, when God threw the devil through Lucifer, and he became the devil, the deceiver. See, the first ones that he deceived were the angels, the created beings. They went with him to attempt to overthrow God. He deceived the angels. And then his second deception was fastened upon Sister Eve. He came down in the garden. Sin was born in heaven in the heart of Lucifer. God did not create sin. God did not create the devil. Why, you say, Brother Green, you just said that God created the devil. I didn't say any such thing. I said God created this creature that was perfect in wisdom, perfect in beauty, and perfect in all of his ways. God created him perfect in wisdom, beauty, and he made himself a devil. He became the deceiver because he thought in his heart that he'd overthrow God and take God's throne. The devil is a self-made creature. The devil is a self-made personality. He is the deceiver. He deceived the angels, and sin was born in heaven, and then sin was brought down to the Garden of Eden when the devil stepped in and said, Eve, hath God said, thou shalt not eat of every tree of the garden? Now, that's the day that sin invaded the earth there in the Garden of Eden. Now then, so God created hell for the devil and his angels. Matthew 25, 41. God created hell for the devil and the devil's angels. Not for man. Not for man. Now, it's true that the devil is not in hell today, but the devil will be put into the lake of fire. Now, when I refer to hell, I'm talking about the prison of the damned. I'm talking about the place that burns with fire and brimstone right now. And I'm talking about the place that after the great white throne judgment will be called the lake of fire. And it will burn on and on and on and on throughout the ceaseless ages of the great eternity that lies ahead. Now, I know that some of you are shrugging your shoulders. And some of you are saying, well, Mr. Green, I never thought you'd preach that kind of a God. Listen, beloved, I preach the Bible. I challenge you. It makes no difference to me who you are, Protestant, Catholic, Jew, Greek Orthodox. It doesn't make any difference who you are. I challenge you to get your Bible. Sit with me day by day as we discuss this subject. And as I give you the verses of Scripture, you read them and reread them and see whether or not I'm giving you what the Word of God has to say. Now, keep this in mind. There was no hell in the beginning. When God created the heaven and the earth, God did not create a hell. God created hell when he had to have a place to chain these angels who left their first estate and decided to overthrow God. Now, they're chained. That's in the book of Jude. I'll give you the verse in just 1 minute. I'm turning. If you'll turn to the little book of Jude, next to Revelation, I'll show you the verse that I'm talking about. And here's what it says. And, this is verse 6, and the angels, which kept not their first estate, but left their own habitation, he hath reserved in everlasting chains under darkness unto the judgment of the great day. Now that's the great white throne judgment when the church will sit with Jesus and judge angels. Don't you know that Paul rebuked the Corinthians for going to law one with another and for carrying their problems and their troubles before unbelievers and going to law, believer with believer, going to law and arguing their cases before unbelievers Why, he said, don't you know that the church will judge angels? Now, that's what he's talking about. So that's the reason you have a hell. But now listen, the only people that will go to hell and the only people that will spend eternity in hell are the people who choose to have the same spirit that the angels and Lucifer had. Lucifer decided that he'd overthrow God. Lucifer decided that he'd take God's throne, and so he told these angels what he was going to do, and they went with him. Most of the angels did not. Certainly, the majority of them did not. But some of the angels were deceived and led astray by Lucifer, and he and these angels attempted to overthrow God, and God threw them out. So God had to create a prison, God had to create a penitentiary, and these angels are chained in darkness. You say, preacher, I thought you said there's fire there. There is. There is fire there. And we'll find it in the Word of God. We'll study it, and I'll prove it to you. They're chained in darkness, waiting until the great white throne judgment, when hell will give up all the dead that are in it. They'll be judged, and then death and hell and all the wicked will be cast into the lake of fire. Now, somebody is saying right now, Mr. Green, if when a sinner dies, they go straight to hell, as you say they do, then tell me why, in the name of common sense, would there be a resurrection and a judgment? Beloved, that is as clear can be. Now, let me illustrate in a couple of minutes, and then I must pray. Now, listen. Here's a man. He commits murder. Cold blood, first degree murder. And everybody knows it. Many witnessed him commit this terrible murder. All right? He's arrested. He's arrested. All right. They carry him down to the city jail. All right. They put him in a cell. They lock him up. He's in jail. He hasn't been tried. He hasn't been tried. He stays in jail maybe a month, maybe 6 weeks, maybe 2 months, maybe 3 months. It depends. Then he's brought before the judge. And the judge passes sentence. And he says, sir, I condemn you to die in the electric chair of the gas chamber for first-degree murder. All right. So he's carried to death row, and he's put in the electric chair or the gas chamber. Now listen, hell is the city jail as compared to the penitentiary. Here's another man, he commits a crime, they put him in jail, he stays there until his trial, then the judge, he's tried, they give him life in prison. Well, he stays in the city jail, he's tried, he's sent to the penitentiary for life. Hell is the city jail. At the end of the church age, that is, at the end of all things, hell will be brought before the judgment. Every sinner that's died and gone to hell will be judged, and then all the wicked will be cast into the lake of fire, and every wicked person will be tormented according to the intensity of their wickedness. They will be judged according to their wickedness and be rewarded according to their wickedness. Now, let me tell you something now. The thing for you to do is to make sure that you don't die in sin. Make sure that you don't wake up in hell. And the way to do that is to trust Jesus and do it now, because tomorrow may be too late. 30 minutes from now may be too late. So I beg you, do it now. Father, save the soul that's nearest hell. Save every soul that's under conviction. And we'll give God the praise in Jesus' precious saving name. Amen. Will you bow your head with me for just a moment of prayer? Our Father, as we study Thy Word today, give us wisdom. And we'll give God the praise for whatever happens in the great unseen radio audience. Dear Lord God, I cannot see the people, but Thou dost know every heart, and I pray that You'll speak to hearts today and save souls for Jesus' sake, we ask it. Amen. Now, today we're continuing our study on the subject hell. I wish I did not have to deliver this series of sermons, but it's imperative that I do so. I have received more letters recently denying the existence of an everlasting hell than I've received in all of my ministry combined up to the last few months. I put a series of sermons in my paper on hell. I believe I wrote 5 sermons, if I remember correctly, on hell, and I sent them out. And, beloved, it stirred up a hornet's nest. You know, the devil doesn't want people to believe there is a literal burning hell. He wants to keep people in the dark concerning hell, and he's doing a good job at it. And there is more error, and there is more false teaching concerning hell today than has ever been in the history of mankind. Now, the first day on the broadcast, I said hell was prepared for the devil and his angels, not for man. And I said in the beginning there was no hell, and I said that Jesus was the man who used the word hell connected with fire in Matthew chapter 5. And then yesterday we talked about the beginning of sin and why God was forced to prepare a hell. Now, then today, I want to tell you from the Word of God, not what I think, not what I believe, but I want to show you from the Word of God where hell is. Now, some of you believe that hell is the grave. Some of you believe other things about hell, but let's see what the Bible says about hell. Now, in the book of Matthew, chapter 12, we have the first scripture that I want us to notice today. In Matthew chapter 12, beginning with verse 38, "Then certain of the scribes and the Pharisees answered, saying, Master, we would see a sign from thee." Now that word master means teacher. Teacher, show us a sign. "But he answered and said unto them, An evil and adulterous generation seeketh after a sign, and there shall no sign be given to it, but the sign of the prophet Jonah." Now listen. "For as Jonah was 3 days and 3 nights in the whale's belly, so shall the Son of Man be 3 days and 3 nights in the heart of the earth." As Jonah was 3 days and 3 nights in the whale's belly, so shall the Son of Man be 3 days and 3 nights in the heart of the earth. Now, you say, preacher, what does that have to do with hell? Turn, please, to Acts chapter 2. In Acts 2 and verse 25, "For David speaketh concerning him," now that's talking about Jesus, "I foresaw the Lord always before my face," all right, "for he is on my right hand, that I should not be moved. Therefore did my heart rejoice, and my tongue was glad. Moreover, also my flesh shall rest in hope." Now, notice the next verse. Notice what it says. Listen carefully. "Because thou wilt not leave my soul in hell, neither wilt thou suffer thine Holy One to see corruption." Now, beloved, listen, don't cut the radio off, please, for the next 5 minutes. Listen carefully to what I'm going to say. Do not cut your radio off, but listen carefully, and I'll explain to you exactly what I'm talking about. Now, a person wrote me the other day and said, "Brother Green, somebody told me that Jesus actually went to hell." Well, he did. Now, he did not go to the torment side of hell. In the Old Testament era, hell had two compartments. And I'll give you scripture for it. I'm not asking you to take anything I say if I do not give you the Word of God to back it up. In the Old Testament era, hell was in two compartments. One side was the torment side, the other side was the paradise side. Now, Jesus actually went to the paradise side of hell. He descended into the heart of this earth, into the paradise side of hell, and he preached, or he delivered the message of redemption to the spirits that were resting there. Then, when Jesus arose from the dead, Matthew tells us that many of the bodies, now this is in Matthew chapter 27, I want you to read it, and I want you to notice very carefully what it says. In Matthew 27 and verse 51, "And behold, the veil of the temple was rent in twain from top to bottom, and the earth did quake, and the rocks rent, and the graves, the graves were opened. And many bodies," B-O-D-I-E-S, bodies, not spirits, not souls, but bodies. Man is a trinity. Man has a body, man has a soul, man has a spirit. God formed man out of the dust of the earth. God made man out of the dust of the earth. Man is made out of dust, but your soul is not dust. God made Adam out of the dust of the earth, and then God breathed into his nostrils, and Adam, who was already a man, became a living soul. Now, listen, beloved, there are a lot of ideas in this land, and there are a lot of teaching, but let's stick to the Word of God. Listen, I don't have any axes to grind. I don't have any religions to defend. I don't have any denomination telling me what to preach. I don't have anybody telling me how to preach. I'm just giving you the Word of God. God made Adam out of dust, and he was a man. He was a dust man. But God breathed into his nostrils, and he became a living soul. And when a man dies, the body goes back to the dust, and the spirit goes back to the Lord who gave it. The spirit is the part of man that thinks. The soul is the part of man that loves and hates. And the body is the house, the dust house, made of dust, that the soul and the spirit lives in. Now then, Jesus Christ, the Son of God, when he arose from the dead, the Bible very plainly says many bodies arose, bodies of the saints. And the graves were open, and many bodies of the saints which slept arose, and came out of the graves after his resurrection, and went into the holy city, and appeared unto many. Now then, in Ephesians chapter 4, I want you to turn to it, please, and turn just as quickly as you possibly can. Ephesians chapter 4, and here's what we find. Verse 7, "But unto every one of us is given grace according to the measure of the gift of Christ. Wherefore he saith, when he ascended up on high." All right? Now, in Acts 1, while the disciples looked steadfastly, Jesus was taken up into heaven. He ascended. Now then, wherefore he saith, when he ascended up on high, he led captivity captive, and he gave gifts unto men. Now that he ascended, what is it but that he also descended first? He descended first. I'm reading Ephesians 4:9. Please turn. He descended first into the lower parts of the earth. He that descended is the same also that ascended up far above all heavens, that he might fill all things. Now, that's Ephesians 4, verses 7, 8, 9, and 10. Ephesians 4, 7 through 10. Now, let me give you the picture. Jesus said, "I'll give you one sign. As Jonah spent 3 days and 3 nights in the belly of the whale, so shall the Son of Man spend 3 days and 3 nights in the H-E-A-R-T, in the center of this earth." Now, David said, referring to Jesus, prophesying concerning Jesus, that his flesh would rest in hope, and he said, "He will not leave my soul in hell." Now, when Jesus died, they put his body in Joseph's tomb. Jesus handed his spirit back to God, and his soul descended into the lower parts of this earth, and there Jesus announced to the Old Testament saints that redemption had been finished and salvation had been brought down. And when Jesus came out of the paradise and walked out of the grave, the saints, he brought them out with him. Now that's as clear can be. He led captivity captive, and then he carried those saints on up far above all heavens. You remember when Mary walked up, when Mary thought she saw the gardener, and she said, "Where have you laid my Lord? Where have you carried him? Where did they take him?" And Jesus turned around and said, "Mary!" And she recognized his voice, and Jesus said, "Don't touch me yet. I have not ascended to my Father, to my God and your God. Don't touch me yet, Mary." And he ascended to the Father. And when he did, he carried the spirits of all the righteous that had died since Adam. He carried those spirits to the paradise above. In 2 Corinthians chapter 3, chapter 12. 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 1, 2, 3, and 4. You'll find that Paul made a visit to that same paradise, far above the heavens. There are three heavens, 1, 2, and 3. Number 1 is where the clouds are. Number 2 is where the planets are. Number 3 is above the heavens. It's the third one. And it's where God is. That's where paradise is now. Before the resurrection of Jesus, paradise was in the heart of this earth. The rich man died in hell. He opened his eyes. He saw Lazarus. He begged for water. He asked Abraham to send Lazarus to his daddy's house. Abraham said, between us and you, there is a great gulf fixed. Between you and us, between the righteous and the unrighteous, there is a great gulf fixed. And we can't pass to you and you can't pass to us. Now the righteous were on one side and the wicked were on the other side. Jesus descended into the paradise side of hell. His soul descended into the paradise side of hell and told the people there, the souls, the righteous, the spirits, that he had shed his blood and redemption had been purchased and salvation had been brought down. And then he brought all of those spirits out and he carried them far above the heavens. Now, I've given you the scripture. I've given you the scripture, verse by verse by verse. All right. Now, let's go just a little bit further. Turn, if you will, to the book of Revelation, and let me read another passage. In the book of Revelation, chapter 9, verse 1, "And the fifth angel sounded, and I saw a star fall from heaven unto the earth, and to him was given the key of the bottomless pit." Now, I know some of you are saying, "Well, Brother Green, what about that star business there? What are you going to do with that?" Not a thing in the world. Jesus said, "I saw Satan as lightning fall from heaven." He saw Satan fall, and he was such a shining creature that his fall looked like a streak of lightning through the sky. Now, this is an angel. Angels are ministering spirits to the heirs of salvation. And this angel is one of God's deputy sheriffs, we'll say. And so John saw an angel, and the Bible refers to him, a personality. He looked like a bright star shooting through the sky. You see, the Bible's not any trouble to understand if you'll just let God's Holy Spirit speak to you. And if you'll just junk all of your ideas and religions and isms and schisms and schisms and all the rest of it, and just let God speak to your heart. Listen, beloved, don't ever try to defend a tradition or a religion or a dogma. Read the Bible. Believe the Bible. Let the Bible speak. The star, the hymn that fell looked like a star shooting through the sky. It's a person. It's an angel. In other words, a being. Let me put it that way. It's a being. "To him was given the key to the bottomless pit." That's hell. All right? "He opened the bottomless pit. And there arose a smoke," S-M-O-K-E. Now, if that had been fog, I believe God would have said fog. I don't think God would have said smoke. He'd have said fog. And if it had been a mist, I think God would have said mist, not smoke. But God says in the Bible, "A smoke came out of the pit as the smoke of a great furnace." All right. "And the sun and the air were darkened by reason of the smoke of the pit." Now, hell is a place, beloved. It's a bottomless pit. It's in the center of this earth. This earth is round. Scientists tell us of late that it may be kind of a pear shape. Well, it doesn't matter. It's still a sphere. And it's round, and hell is bottomless. It's bottomless. It is in the center of this earth. It's a proven fact that the bowels of this earth is a mass of melted, red-hot, liquid rock and fire. Now, that's a proven fact. You can go right here in this country of ours, and there are boiling springs, and you, no doubt, many of you have seen volcanoes. I was down in South America and made movies from an airplane of a volcano erupting. That is, the smoke was pouring out of the side or the top of the mountain. And we flew so close to it that the ashes settled on the windows of the plane as we flew around the volcano. Many of you have seen pictures, and maybe some of you have even seen live volcanoes. Well, that's not a thing in the world, but just red-hot melted rock pouring out the side of a mountain. That's all it is. Now, this earth, the center of this earth, is a mass of red-hot fire. All right. Now, I'm not going to read the rest of these verses. I don't have time. But you'll notice in verse 11, "And they," these monstrosities that came out of the smoke, And they had a king over them, which is the angel of the bottomless pit. They had a king, which is the angel of the bottomless pit, whose name in the Hebrew tongue is Abaddon, and in the Greek tongue is Apollyon. Now, there is a description in the book of Revelation of the bottomless pit in the center of this earth, and it is a pit that has within it fire and smoke. And when God sent down this angel to unlock and uncap and open up the door to this bottomless pit, so much smoke boiled out that it blacked out the sun. It absolutely engulfed the whole earth and cut off the sunlight. Now that's how much smoke poured out when God opened the door, that is, when the angel that God sent down opened the door and uncapped hell, unlocked the bottomless pit, so much smoke poured out that it blacked out the whole earth. Now that's hell, beloved. It's in the center of this earth. Jesus said, I'll give you no sign except the sign of the prophet Jonah. He was 3 days, 3 nights in the belly of a whale. The Son of Man will be 3 days and 3 nights in the center, the heart of the earth. And then, in Acts 2, thou wilt not leave my soul in hell. When Jesus died, his soul descended into the paradise side of hell. At that time, all the righteous went to the paradise in the heart of the earth. All the wicked went to hell, the other side, and between the two there was a great gulf. Luke 16. All right. So when Jesus went down into paradise, he announced to the spirits there that the debt had been paid, his blood had been shed. He arose, he led captivity captive, and he ascended far above the heavens with the spirits of the righteous. He carried them to the paradise above. In 2 Corinthians 12, 1 through 4, Paul was caught up into that paradise. In Revelation chapter 9, God sends an angel down. He unlocks the bottomless pit. Smoke comes out, blacks out the sun. There is an angel over an army that comes out, an army of demon monstrosities that come out of the smoke. Beloved, there is a hell. Hell is a place. Hell is in the center of this earth. We're going to have a new earth one of these days. There'll be no hell in the center of it. And I'll tell you about it before the series is over. But here's the thing that I want to tell you now. I pray, I beg, I beseech with all of my heart that you prepare now to stay out of hell. Please don't go. God doesn't want you to go. Jesus doesn't want you to go. I don't want you to go. God help you to be saved. Right now is my prayer. Bow your head, close your eyes, confess your sins, and ask God to have mercy upon you, and He will. Heavenly Father, save many souls as they call upon you now. Redeem the lost, and we'll give God the praise in Jesus' saving name. Amen. Our Father, as we study Thy Word, give us wisdom. Speak to my heart, and speak through these lips of clay to the unseen thousands in the radio land. Father, I can't see them, but they're there. Dear Lord God, there are varied and sundry needs out there. I do not know the need. I do not know the heart. But Father God, you see the heart and you know the need. So I pray that you'll save souls and we'll give God the praise. In Jesus' name, amen. Now today I'm delivering message number 4 on hell. And I want you to listen carefully. Now so far I have shown you from the Word of God that Jesus was the first one to use the words hell fire in the Bible. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 5, if a man call his brother a fool, he's in danger of hell fire. Now, listen, beloved, there are so many arguments against hell being the grave and some of the teachings concerning hell today that it's almost needless for me to even refer to them. But now, Jesus said, if you call your brother a fool, you're in danger of hell fire. Now, people, there are thousands of them, there are tens of thousands of them, that will tell you without hesitation and without blinking their eye that the grave is hell. So I suppose what Jesus said was, if you call your brother a fool, you're in danger of the grave. Now, is that right? Is that right? No, it isn't right. Now, listen, beloved. Hell is a place that has been prepared since God made the heaven and the earth. In the beginning, God created heaven and earth, but He didn't make a hell then because they need one. Now, later, sometime later, I do not know when, the devil who was not a devil at that time, but he was the shining one, the anointed cherub, he decided to overthrow God, and he led some of the angels astray with him. And this shining one, the anointed cherub, Lucifer, and some of the angels decided they'd take God's throne, pitch God off. So God threw them, God cast them out. Jesus said, I saw Satan as lightning fall from heaven. Now, when God cast out Satan and the angels, God prepared hell, a prison, a penitentiary, and the angels are chained in darkness, in everlasting chains now, awaiting the day of judgment. Now, I proved yesterday on the radio from the Word of God, I didn't try to prove anything that I believe, but I read Matthew 12, Acts 2, Matthew 27, Ephesians 4, Revelation 9, and I showed you from the Word of God without a doubt that hell is in the center of this earth on which we live today. Now, at the consummation of all things, at the beginning of the everlasting ages, hell will be cast into the lake of fire. We'll have a new heaven, a new earth, and hell will not be in the center of the earth as it is today. Now then, I want to answer some questions today that I feel need to be answered, and the only way to answer them is from the Word of God. What is hell, and who is in hell, if anybody now, and what are they doing now, and so on, what kind of bodies do they have? What happens to the wicked when they die? Now, the only place to get the answers is in the Word of God. Now, turn, please, to Luke 16, a passage that people who deny hell hate worse than any other passage in the Bible, and they say it's a parable, but it isn't. Now, in Luke chapter 16, in verse 19, there was a certain rich man which was clothed in purple and fine linen and fared sumptuously every day. And there was a certain beggar named Lazarus. Now, this is often referred to as the parable of Lazarus and Dives. Beloved, I do wish from the depths of my heart that men would let the Word of God alone, leave it alone, and let it say, where is Dives? And where is anything in here about a parable? There's no suggestion that this is a parable. There is absolutely no suggestion that this passage is a parable. Now, I'll prove to you, if you'll stay with me through the broadcast, and maybe tomorrow we may have to continue, if you'll stay with me until we study this chapter, analyze it, and add two and two together, spiritually speaking, you'll see as plain as a nose on your face that no man has any right to call this a parable. All right. There was a certain rich man, which was clothed in purple and linen, and he fared sumptuously every day. Now, this man was a fanatical man. I mean by that he was a fanatic about clothes. Now, I know good and well that some of you people know some rich man right now, maybe he's a multimillionaire, and he may be fanatical about automobiles. I read not so long ago where some fellow bought 5 Cadillacs, all a different color, and he bought the Cadillacs to match his suits. Imagine that. He had 5 suits, and he bought a Cadillac to match these suits. Of course, I'm sure he had more suits than that, but he bought these 5 Cadillacs to match suits. When he wore a certain suit, he drove a Cadillac to match the suit. Think of it. Spending $5,000 or $6,000 or $7,000 for an automobile to match a suit of clothes. Well, now, that is a streak of fanaticism. That's what it is. I mean, by that's no reflection on anybody, but this particular person was fanatical about clothes and automobiles. You might be fanatical about flowers. You might be fanatical about antiques. You may be fanatical about hats or shoes or ties or cufflinks or something else. Now, this man was a rich man that was known for his purple and fine linen and faring sumptuously 365 days in the year. There was a certain rich man. And there was a certain beggar named Lazarus. Now listen, beloved. Jesus said a sower went forth to sow. Jesus said a certain man had 2 sons. And Jesus said many, many times, Jesus taught in parables. But my dearly beloved by the radio, please give me your undivided attention. The Son of God never named a man in a parable. Never, never, never. A certain man had 2 sons, but he didn't name them. The younger said to the father. And then the elder came home, and he was peeved, you see. a certain man, see, and the sower went forth to sow, but it didn't name the sower. And in other words, it's just as plain as the nose on your face. Now, here's the thing about it, see. I am not trying to prove a religion. I'm not trying to defend a religion. I'm not trying to live up to a tradition, and I'm not trying to pacify some church. I just read the Word of God. There's the verse. I read it, and let the verse say what it will say. I don't have to prove anything. I'm not trying to prove anything. You see, the trouble today, and I say this in love, and I say it with a sad and a broken heart, the trouble today, we are divided up into religious tradition and denomination and schools of thought and more people. Now listen to what I'm saying. Weigh the statement before you condemn me. More preachers today, I am afraid, are trying to defend their religion and defend their denomination and defend some tradition. More preachers are trying to do that than are preaching the Word of God and the gospel just like it's laid down in this precious Bible. Now, I say that tenderly. I say it from a heart of love. But I am not trying to defend anybody or any religion. I just read the verse. There was a certain beggar named Lazarus, which was laid at his gate full of sores. Now, listen, beloved. If there was not a beggar named Lazarus laid at a rich man's gate that wore purple and fine linen, if that didn't happen, since Jesus said there was a certain rich man, he wore certain garments, there was a certain beggar, his name was Lazarus, he was carried and he was laid at the rich man's gate, and the dogs came and licked his sores. Now, if that didn't happen, then that scripture is misleading. And brother, please, in the name of common sense, don't accuse the Bible of lying. Please don't. Please don't. Now, let me illustrate. It's just plain as the nose on your face. Now, my home is Greenville, South Carolina. Suppose I announce on the radio today, I'm trying my best to help you people. Beloved, if you could read my mail, you'd understand why I go slow and why I repeat, why I hammer, 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 hammer. If you could read my mail, there are thousands of honest, sincere people in this country that their mind is being warped and twisted, and their mind is being driven by tradition and the doctrines of men, and they read these pamphlets, and they read this literature, and God bless your soul, they write to me and say, well, now, Brother Green, what are we going to believe? You say this, and this one says that, and somebody else says something else. Now, who in the world are we going to believe? Listen, you believe the Bible. You believe God's Word, and don't you believe anybody else. Now, I'm trying to show you something. I live in Greenville, South Carolina, the textile center of the world. And suppose I announced on the radio this morning that I went up on the street last night, and I preached on the streets of Greenville, and we had a very outstanding conversion. And let's say that I announced on the radio that we had a gentleman, quite an old man, saved, and he said his name was Tom Green. We'll use that name, see, Tom Green. My name's Green, so we'll use Green. I announced on the radio that we had an old gentleman that had been an alcoholic, and he was gloriously saved. He came up in tatters, and he fell on his knees, and he prayed out and asked God to save him. And he was wearing rags, tatters, and had an old hat, and he wore glasses, and he had a little diamond ring on his hand. All right, so I make that announcement. Then I finish my sermon, and somebody calls me long distance and says, Brother Green, you know, that was my daddy that you said got saved last night on the street meeting, see? Now, Brother Green, my daddy was named Tom Green, and my dad has been an alcoholic, and we've lost trace of him, and the last time we heard of him, he said he was going to Greenville, South Carolina, and my dad had a little diamond that he always wore, see? Then when you get through talking and you're just praising God and saying, hallelujah, that's my daddy, preacher, that's my daddy. And then suppose when you finish, I say, oh, well, they, no, I was just using that as an illustration. I was just giving a parable, so to speak. I didn't have a drunk saved last night named Tom Green that was in tatters and had a little diamond on his face. No, that didn't really happen. I was just telling that to try to stir up the people in Radio Land, see? It didn't happen. No, I don't even know a fella named Tom Green, see? Then you'd say Oliver Green just lied on the radio. Oliver Green said he had a drunk saved last night, And Oliver Green said his name was so-and-so, and Oliver Green said he had on... Why, he just lied. That preacher just lied. Now, let me tell you something, brother. When you start pointing out specific cities and giving specific names, and when you start telling how a man dresses, and when you start putting all these specific things about a specific thing, then, brother, it had better be truth, or you'd better tell folks I'm just kidding you in the first place. Now, let me tell you something. Son of God's not kidding about this business of hell. No, sir. God is not kidding. Jesus is not kidding. There was a certain rich man, and there was a certain beggar. They both lived in the same city. The rich man didn't need to be named. He was known by his clothes. The beggar was named Lazarus, and he was laid at the rich man's gate, and the dogs came and licked his sores. Now, that's no parable, my friend. That man actually lived. The rich man actually lived, and Lazarus actually lived. They both lived in the same city. Now, and it came to pass, verse 22, came to pass that the beggar died and was carried by the angels into Abram's bosom. The rich man also died and was buried. And in hell he lift up his eyes, being in torments, and seeth Abraham afar off and Lazarus in his bosom. And he cried and said, Father Abraham, have mercy on me, and send Lazarus that he may dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am tormented in this flame. Now, I'm stopping right there. Won't talk to you, and then if time permits, we'll read a little bit further. All right. Now, these two men lived in the same town. One was known by his clothes. The other was known by his sores, and his name was Lazarus. Came to pass, the beggar died. Now, I can see some people, God bless you, and brother, I know whereof I speak. You don't kid me. I've been preaching the gospel almost a quarter of a century. You don't fool me, brother. I tell you, there's a few things I know. And one thing I know when God is speaking, and I know when the devil's fighting. Some dear people right now are saying, I wonder what old Green's going to do with that Abraham's bosom. I received a letter just 2 days ago, and the person says, don't you imagine Lazarus had a hard time getting into Abraham's bosom? And don't you imagine that Abraham was very uncomfortable with a beggar in his bosom? Oh, yes. You know, let me say this tenderly. Let me say this in love. You see, since I don't have to defend some religion, and since I don't have to defend some preacher and some doctrine and some dogma, you see, I don't have any trouble. You refer to a babe in a mother's bosom. A bosom is a place of rest for a babe. Abraham is the father of the faithful, the friend of God. Abraham was God Almighty's friend. He won for himself by his faithfulness to God the title Faithful Abraham. He's the father of the righteous, and the righteous are resting in Abraham's bosom. Yes, sir, indeed. Just like a little babe rests in its mother's bosom. Yes, sir. In other words, all in the world you have to do to understand the Bible is junk your ideas, junk your tradition, junk your religion, and throw everything overboard but the Bible, and read it, and let God's Holy Spirit interpret it, and let God's Holy Spirit speak to you, and let God say what He says, and let it alone, and you have no trouble whatsoever. So, the angels carried Lazarus to Abraham's bosom, sure, yeah. And it came to pass that the beggar died and was carried by the angels into Abraham's bosom, the place of rest, the paradise of God, just like a babe rests upon its mother's bosom. Lazarus went to Abram's bosom, the place of rest. No trouble. You don't need... It's not hard to see that, beloved. Now, let's read on now. The rich man also died and was buried. He died and he was buried. They dug a grave and they put him in the grave. And the next verse says, and in the grave he lifted up... No, I'm not trying to prove a religion or defend a religion. I'm not trying to prove a point. I'm just reading the Word of God. The rich man died and was buried. They buried him. And in hell, H-E-L-L, he lift up his eyes, being in torment, and seeth Abraham afar off and Lazarus in his bosom. Now this man saw Abraham and recognized Abraham, and he saw Lazarus, and he recognized Lazarus resting in the bosom of Abraham. Just like a babe rests on its mother's breast. That's right. Just like a babe rests on its precious mother's bosom. That's the way that Abraham, or Lazarus, was resting on the bosom of Abraham. Now then, the rich man died and was buried. They buried him. They buried his body. He died. They buried him. And in hell, he opened his eyes. Now, beloved, listen. If you want to know the truth and you want to face the truth, you can see at a glance that this man did not die and then open his eyes in a grave and begin to talk in a grave. Never. The rich man died. He went straight to hell. He opened his eyes in the flames of hell and he began to scream for a drop of water. He said, I'm tormented in this F-L-A-M-E. And let me say today, because my time has slipped up on me and it's gone and I must close. Let me say this. I beg you and I plead with you from the depths of my soul and the bottom of my heart. I beg you and I plead with you not to go on in sin. Don't gamble with eternity and do not gamble with the devil and die in your sin and wake up in hell. I beg you to give your heart to Jesus right now and let him save you so that you won't go to this awful place of torment. Tomorrow, I'll continue this same scripture, so please be with us. Father, in the name of Jesus, help precious, sincere, honest-hearted people to see the truth and to receive the truth as it's laid down in God's Word. We ask it in Jesus' precious name. Amen.